Welcome in, Suns fans. Sorry for the late start, but word of warning, never try and order a Uber Eats delivery to arrive before your shows to get started, because you will always be left disappointed on that. But I have my cup of coffee here. We've got our great co-host, Kevin from the Philippines. Welcome back, Kevin.
Hey, thanks for having me back. And I'm so excited to be here, you know, excellent. Always.
And of course, you all know the Thunder from Down Under, the man with the plan, Sir Hammo.
What's up?
Great. Less is always more. Welcome back in, Suns fans, to the Suns Planet Pod. Interesting week. We ended with a two-game win streak, and we're about ready to fire up again here in a matter of hours against the San Antonio Spurs. But based on the Suns Twitter, which, you know, is always the most logical, reliable, grounded, and just, you know, calm fan base. We don't go too high, we don't go too low. That's the best part about being a fan with this team, is that but it seems a little different this week. That loss against the Bucks, a Giannis-less Bucks, where we just decided to let Bobby Portis absolutely destroy us. Let's start with that, and then let's finish with some talks of those victories. But let me recap it here for the Suns fans. And talk about the Bucks game that we had last was it Sunday here in the States. We went up against a classic Jay Crowder who had 18 points. Chris Middleton actually decided to play, which I have him on my fantasy team, and that seems like a first. I don't think he's been playing for weeks. He was able to come in, get 22 points against us. Dame Lillard, of course, Dame time, 31 points, and the terrifying Bobby Portis scored 31 and 10. We did have some rays of hope, though, for the Suns. We did have Booker chip in 23, Beal 28, and Grayson Allen 25. What was interesting was Kevin Durant played 42 minutes, 11 points, 9 rebounds. He was doing some other stuff. But let's, Kevin, initial thoughts on that Bucks game. Is it, is it just kind of more of the same that we've seen with this team, or is there more that we can take from it?
Probably it's just the same ride that we've been riding along all season long. You know, I think we've been losing to starless teams as well in the past. That just speaks, inconsistencies and all that. But I don't want to read into much the stats that happened last Sunday. I think we shot poorly from three. KD really did struggle that game. So
what was interesting about KD, 4 for 10. He had not taken such few amount of shots for quite some time. 4 of 10, 1 from 3 from 3-point range. And actually, turnovers was not his biggest concern in that particular game. He only had one. He actually had a few steals and a couple blocks. So we actually got defensive Kevin Durant. Why were we unable to defeat the Bucks without their best player?
Kevin Durant's allowed to have time off every now and again, isn't he? He doesn't have to always be KD. I don't know, man. I've been pretty positive up until recently about, we'll be okay, we'll be okay. We're subterfuge. I'm starting to get a little bit worried.
I think you should be worried.
The best part for audio listeners that aren't tuning in, Ammo had the perfect timing to just start chipping away at his nails as he starts biting down and goes, guys, I know we've been saying we're going to be okay, but starts chewing his nails. I'm starting to get nervous. I don't know if I was being
look,
serious.
If nothing else, I'm a performer. I don't know, man. I don't know. But you look through the box score and, every person that played scored except for Ish Wainwright. He had 3 minutes and he didn't score any points. No rebounds, no assists. So everyone did have a go. I don't know why we're losing shitty games like this, man. I mean, the Bucks aren't what they were 2 years ago. Their team's completely been turned on their head. Not saying they're not good. They're just, they're having to learn with a new system, a new set of role players.
Yeah, I remember tweeting out. I remember tweeting out during the game that why does every time the Suns play some role player like plays the biggest superstar or all-star? It's always like that, you know.
Well, and I feel like for the Bobby Portises out there, I feel like Bobby is one of those recurring characters in the Suns' nightmares. It's just like, it's kind of one of those, I don't have the drop ready, but I suppose it might not even apply. Because at this point, we don't need to say who in the Daffy Duck is this guy. We know who Bobby Portis is. He haunts us in our dreams. And so Bobby Portis is a true role player for the Milwaukee Bucks that just seems to get a little bit more excited because I don't know if he just knows the Suns' system or knows the Suns players are enough or just has that extra dose of confidence that he, when he sees those uniforms, he goes, oh my gosh,
he brings it so hard against the Suns, man. And there are people in the league that do it. But yeah, I don't know.
I think what a lot of Suns fans have been talking about, with regard to this week is, and I'm curious if you guys think this is kind of the theme of this week, is effort. Show me that you guys want to win this stuff, because we keep hearing in every post game, Bradley Beal's been very candid of late, which is great to see from a player. He's a little bit more upfront, I think, than KD and Booker can be in their interviews sometimes. And it's very much, hey, we're putting things together. It's a process. You have, a few stars and a lot of changeover and role players. So it's going to take time to do that. We're going to keep following the process. And so, I think we understand that. We might've gotten a little excited at the beginning of the season, just like, yeah, slap them all together. This is going to totally work. Build the chemistry, but show us that you want to. And I think that's kind of what's interesting. Cause if in my opinion, it's been very much fits and starts. Like I think it was the game that we'll talk about here momentarily against the 76ers where, I think we started like 0-for-8 and or something, just kind of very awkward. And Yusuf Nurkic had like, I actually sent out a tweet about it. We were down 13 points, but he had like 14, we had a 14 rebound advantage 6 minutes into the first quarter. Like we were controlling the glass and we were still getting beat by double digits. It was insane to see. And so it was a little bit like, you'd see somebody like a Yusuf putting in the energy to go get the missed shots. But then you'd see kind of guys drop their head and just be like, oh man, okay. And they kind of would fall into the rhythm of frustration. But we can talk a little bit more about that. Let's start back with Hamo on this one. The 76ers game, no Joel Embiid and no Tobias Harris for the 76ers. But here the Suns do take care of business, 115-102. Of course, there was a fourth quarter meltdown. I know that seems like such a surprise anymore, but we were outscored 36-25 in that fourth quarter, which kind of made things a little interesting towards the end. Kelly Oubre had 18 points against us. He was leading the 76ers scorers. And then the Suns had a 32-point game from a Grayson Allen who was dang so close to getting his 10 three-pointers in that game. Grayson Allen was just sniping before he was trying to force that last one in. A couple other highlights. Devin Booker was one rebound away from a triple-double. He had 18 points, 11 assists, 9 rebounds. And Yusuf Nurkic had 10 and 14. Very solid game. But the 76ers game, Hamo, what were some of your takeaways there?
As the fourth quarter meltdown was going on, I'm saying to myself, we cannot get taken out by Tsunami Puppy. We cannot let Kelly Oubre get to us. Hey, Hunster. It was a good game, man, but I'll tell you what, it was good to see the bench get cleared at the end of it. And, yeah, we got to see some Thad minutes, only a couple.
We got Thad minutes. Yes, we did get a minute and 48 seconds of Thad.
Exactly young. Right.
Yeah. We got two blocks in the game.
It was the Thaddiest, most Thad Young minutes I've ever seen.
I think you also wanted to highlight then by pointing out Thad Young that Isaiah Thomas made his Phoenix Suns debut for the second time in his career. welcome back to the Valley, IT. Hope you like it a little bit more than this last time when you kind of took your ball and went out east because we had to split up the three-headed point guard dragon. The Goran Dragic, Eric Bledsoe, Isaiah Thomas. What were we thinking?
The happy days.
They were tough days, weren't they? Yeah. Far out.
That was an interesting experiment into the whole, hey, it's positionless basketball. Everyone's just playing. Bledsoe was a great defender. Goran could, body up with some of the bigger guys. And then she's like, IT, of course, could not. Just the thought of all three of them out there at different times. And now we've kind of switched that a little bit. We have no point guard. We have three. And now we have no point guard, really. And we try and have Booker, Durant, and Beal all share those duties. So very interesting.
At that stage, man, I wouldn't be surprised if they started IT at center. We just had no idea what we were doing then, didn't we? Man, they were dark days.
Yeah, that's where analytics does not always, compute all the time because it's you just see three very productive players and you think, well, if we plug them in here, it works. And sometimes they actually make each other all take a step back. But a little bit more on that 76ers game, Kev, what were your thoughts on? I mean, like I said, we took care of business. And I mean, isn't that the most important thing right now?
Yeah, it is important. And the thing is, as that game started, we started like 0-for-8, and then we had more turnovers than field goals to start, and we're down like was it 25-11, or was that the Hawks game? Sorry,
it might have been both. I think it was both. Basically, we went down double digits early in both.
Right, and then glad Bosnian was there because of all the rebounds he pulled down. And actually, if the Suns, if they want to, they can, guarding Tyrese Maxey, that's not an easy accomplishment given that.
He's pretty tight.
Yeah, right. But he was pretty well defended that game. And so that gives me an idea that if the Suns wants to, then they can do it. And certainly some of the games, there are a lot of times that they are like pretty late on their coverages and all that stuff, which leads to wide open threes. So I think it's just the effort just needs to be consistent over there, to win all this, or at least make a statement before the season ends.
Well, and I love your reference there to Tyrese Maxey too. So a quick analysis of that game. Tyrese Maxey held to 6 points in that game. 7 assists is all he was able to generate. He was 3-for-13 for 23% shooting overall, 0-from-4 for 3. And just before you say, well, hey, there's no Joel Embiid, it's a little bit more difficult for him. Since then, he had a 27-point game against the Lakers, and the few games before that, 30 points against the Heat, 30 points against the Hornets, 30 points against Milwaukee. I think Tyrese Maxey is a good offensive player, and the Suns were able to just be very effective against him and hold him back. So that was very inspiring to see because I think that's been the concern,
he's
right?
Just, he's just there, right? Mm-hmm. He's just there. God damn, he's a pain in the ass. He's just frustrating, man. Great player. Wish he played for us. Frustrating as hell to go against.
Well, but we took care of business, and that was the important thing. And I think especially coming off that Celtics loss that I believe was last week, with the amount of three-pointers we were giving up, and then followed by the loss to the Bucks. Again, outside shooting, I think a lot of Suns fans wanted to see that return to closeout defense, perimeter defense. If the guy gets past you, he gets past you, let Yusuf play a little bit of post defense and scare him away. I think hopefully we're starting to see us turn that corner again. But we saw it kind of in January, too, where we went on a streak and then we kind of forgot to play perimeter defense a little bit. So, you know, it'll be something to look at. And the Hawks game, we'll pull up here real quick, too. Suns, again, take care of business, 128-115. No Trae Young, no Sadiq Bey for the Atlanta Hawks. And a quick snapshot, DeJounte Murray of the Hawks had 29 points, 9 rebounds, 10 assists. This, again, was another, shocker. Fourth quarter, We did not have a fourth quarter meltdown. We had a fourth quarter victory of 32-22 in that quarter. So we actually, ended up, it seemed a lot closer than that, though. It can happen. We won by 13. It was certainly closer than that final score appeared to be. But Devin Booker was able to get 30. Kevin Durant, 19. Eric Gordon was actually pretty effective from long range, getting 21 points in. And as I mentioned, it was pretty much the DeJounte Murray show for the Hawks. Beating this team again, Kevin, what else can we take away from this one except Suns? These are must-win games, aren't they? I mean, at this they point. Are.
Basically, we've started our playoffs early, and if they continue with the same intensity and finesse at the end game, then certainly we can beat any team. Thing is, when we play healthy teams, that's when you got a question. Will we have the same approach to the game, or are we going to show up and then, just like with the Celtics game, which inspired in the Celtics game? Yeah, it's a concern, definitely. But when you play these, injured teams, it's definitely something or a game that you have to win. So I'm glad that the Suns was able to take care of business. But then again, the challenge would be healthy teams.
Mm-hmm.
That's always really the question.
That's a damn good call, man.
Well, Hamill, is this a Phoenix Suns team that is going to be able to handle their business? I mean, I think a lot of Suns fans are feeling like, to paraphrase Voida of Suns Jam, he's come to peace with the fact that this team is good. It is not great. We can beat the bottom-dwelling teams. We can beat those mid-tier teams. Can we beat the very good teams? And guess what? The next, we have 14 games left. 12 games left. Two are against the Spurs, and the rest are all playoff teams.
Right.
Yeah.
Are we going to be able to rise to the occasion, or are we just going to have to hope that – we beat the Spurs, which, let's be honest, is not a guarantee. If you guys want a betting tip right now, they have the Suns -9.5 against the Spurs. Spurs beat us the other two times that we've played them this year, and they have us almost by double digits. I'm very curious. I want the Suns to win, but I might take those points from the Spurs because I know what a fourth quarter meltdown can look like. But is this going to be a, kind of hold tight, you got to run to the bathroom, clench your butt cheeks, because it's going to be a rough finish here at the end.
It'll be a photo finish.
Exactly.
You asked me a month ago, I would have had a totally different tone. But with every game that comes along, every upcoming game, I get more and more worried, get more and more concerned. We should be a lot better than what we are. I don't understand what the problem is. Yeah. We've gone from being just wait until you say it's in the playoffs kind of team to, are we going to make the play in? You know, like, it's frustrating, dude. It's so frustrating because this is the best team we've had in years on paper. It is the best team with the most talent that we've had in a long time. And we're scraping through games that we should dominate.
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's jump into more of this in the third quarter here. And for this, as we enter from first to second quarter, let's kick it off with a little bit of, recognition for the guys that played well this week. So let's check them out. Might as well be walking on the sun. Love that dunk by Amari. So, Sun Walker of the Week, most impressive to you for the week. Let's go with Kevin first. Kevin, who is standing out in your eyes as, hey, he got it done over these last three games?
Hey, that's no question. It's got to be Grayson Allen.
Oh, well, hold on here. Let me. Oh, of course I buried him. Where is he? There he is. Scary. Got him.
This, can you be scary? Oh, I know the grass can be. Can it be scary? What do you think of this?
I'm Grayson Allen.
I will say that before we created this drop, I actually did not know that there was going to be another Beetlejuice. So now I'm very excited that a whole new generation.
Yeah, we're ahead of the curve on that one.
that one, yes. We were ahead of it. But tell us, Kevin, how was Grayson Allen scaring the opposition this week?
Yeah, so I was crunching some numbers earlier, and not just for the last three, five games, but post All-Star, he's averaging like 48% from three. The last three games, he's 52% in threes. So
he's got as far up as 60, I think.
Really?
At one stage, not right now, but yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but that's just incredible shooting. And, when you have these three guys, KD, Book, and Beal, you got to have some shooters around them to make it, so that they can create space, kick it off, and the shooters will just take care of them. So over the last three games, 52% is just insane, and I don't know what would be a record will be, if we don't have Grayson playing as well as he is right now. I really doubt that we're at 40 wins. But I think he's the most consistent three-point shooter that we have right now outside of the big three. So that's why he's my Sunwalker.
Oh, absolutely.
I hate it when we got guests that come on that actually are smart, articulate, and can make me look.
Ammo,
really
just invite him to your place now. I tell you what, just put him right next to Pat Burke and JC from Chile, and
yeah,
really, Jesse's Ammo's place is gonna have. He's gonna start a timeshare for the. The Suns Planet podcast co-host.
Is timeshare.
Grayson Allen, starting with that Milwaukee game, 25 points, 8 assists. He was 54.5% on three-point shooting, 6 of 11. And, of course, that game against Philadelphia, 32 points, 5 assists, 9 of 15 for that 60% three-point shooting percentage. And then his bad game of the week, he still had 13 points, 4 assists, and 3 of 7 for 42.9% shooting from 3. I think fantastic pick for Grayson Allen. I'm just going to go ahead and jump in and say that Grayson Allen was mine, but I do have a runner-up candidate. But Hamo, who do you have?
Yes, it's Grayson Allen, obviously. Okay. But honorable mention has to go to our man KD for what he did this week on the all-time scoring list. So
okay.
Just to be different, if we wanted to, we'd go with Kevin Durant. Didn't have the greatest week that Kevin Durant can have, but still passing Shaquille O'Neal, another former Sun, and one of the greats.
Big Shaktus.
That's huge. That is huge. And Shaq's little tribute video to him as well was pretty cool.
You might be a king or a little street sweeper, but sooner or later you dance with the Reaper.
Yes, NBA players have been dancing with the Slim Reaper for quite a long time now, and that's how KD was able to move up the shooting ranks this week, getting some love from Shaquille O'Neal and the guys from, was it Inside the NBA? So, all right, decent pick. My runner-up was not going to be the same guy, though, and we'll see. Did I actually put this one in here? I did not. So that was my bad, but I will just name the man Royce O'Neal. Guys, did you forget about Royce for a little bit? I certainly did, because I remember him going like 0-6 for several games. It felt like too many games. Actually, as I look here, in March 11th, he was 0-2 for 0 points in 30 minutes. And in the Boston game, 0-7 for 0 points in 27 minutes. But this week was much better. He was scored 16 points in that Milwaukee game, was 4-9 from three. The 13 points in that Philadelphia game, 3-4 from three, and then 14 points in that Hawks game, 4-6 from three. So, I mean, obviously, guys, when the threes are falling, it's a massively different set for this team, because, you know, Booker and Durant are good three-point shooters. They're not great three-point shooters, and same with Beal. And I think they prefer that mid-range attack game. And so when they do finally start kicking it out, and the reliability of a Grayson Allen, if we can match that at all with a Royce O'Neal. And Royce is always going to be streaky. That's the challenge, right? But the last three games, Royce has been very effective, and I think that's really helped. And, you know, we already know he's a good defender. He's active hands. So for me, it's definitely Grayson Allen, Son Walker. But Royce O'Neal, glad to see he's bathing in the sun warmth, we'll say that. But, you know, there's always got to be one problem with this team. Let's discuss it. In the sun, in my disgrace, black hole sun. The black hole sun.
That
won't you come?
So frustrating.
Wash away the rain. No.
DeAndre, smack in your peasy ass head.
Let it go, Hamo. He does not play on this team anymore.
If he did, it'd be so easy to fill this category.
Well, I know Hamo said he needed a little extra time to figure out who he was going to give the Black Hole Son of the Week to.
Oh,
so
man.
We'll jump in with Kev, unless Kev's not ready either. Otherwise, I'll jump right in.
You go, Jake.
All right. Well, then, this is what's going to be very funny, because, you know, it was an honorable mention for Hamo. And no, I'm not going to play the whole thing again, but Kevin Durant, as much as we were impressed with you achieving and moving up the leaderboards, an 11-point performance, 4-10 against the Milwaukee Bucks in a losing effort, 22 points in the win against Philadelphia, and he had 4 turnovers in that game. And then 19 points in that Hawks effort, 5 turnovers in that game. And it's not like he was playing less minutes. Milwaukee, almost 42, Philadelphia, 36, Atlanta game, 37. So, I mean, he's getting tons of time out there. Is Kevin Durant starting to show age, or is it just, you know, towards the end of the regular season? I mean, you know, those are questions that I'm starting to wonder, is that I'm very worried. I was taking a look at this the other day. Kevin Durant's numbers, you usually want to see a performance increase as players go into the playoffs, right? They step up, they play more minutes. Kevin Durant tends to get more steals, more blocks, more rebounds. He tends to shoot significantly worse in the playoffs, and that could be because teams scheme around him. They know he's arguably the best shooter on the team. But his performance does come down. He might score more overall, but he's certainly less effective at doing so. I hope we're not trending towards seeing that Kevin Durant against the Denver Nuggets performance that we saw last year to kind of close out the playoffs. But this is not really a debate portion of the show. It's a who else is disappointing you guys this week? So let's swing it back over to Hamo. I gave you guys some time.
Yeah, look, the Kevin Durant, I've been a massive Kevin Durant fan since he's came into the league, man. You know, the fact that he plays for my team, my damn team, our team, the Phoenix Suns, it's a dream come true. But you mentioned playoff and him getting further, you know, how's he going to increase his minutes from what he's already doing? He's already playing some high-level minutes. I don't know if he's getting old or not, but I didn't like a lot of what Vogel decided to do this week. Just some strange rotations, some non-challenges and things like that he didn't do. I know it's a little bit off the beaten path, nominating a coach, but it's...
So Coach Vogel's your black hole son?
Coach Vogel, yeah, okay. He is.
Okay.
He is.
I don't have my... I think the only Vogel drop we ever had was actually... Oh, perfect timing, Hamill. I see what you're doing here. The only drop we ever had of Frank Vogel, besides the one that's tied to Eric Gordon, is actually the one where he's trying to explain to the rest of the league the dangers of Wemby after we lost the two games to the Spurs, and he says, he will find you. He will hurt you. And he's explaining that in the Terminator form. As
and Kyle Reese, the first ever F-bomb on the Suns planet.
I should see if I can't pull that up here before the end of the show. But Kev, who's
we'll take that one to find it?
Oh man, I'm gonna be dissed at. although you know, given that he almost had a triple double, in Philly or versus Philly, but that. Shooting woes that he had during the Milwaukee game, the Bucks game, really made me do it. So he was, I didn't think, 0-for-5 from three that game. And there were like a couple of possessions down the stretch where he like bricked two or three threes. That could have completed the comeback. Oh, in case I didn't mention it, it's Book. And I love Book. You know, I've been a Booker fan addict ever since he came into the league. But, you know, when I was watching that game, it's like, you know, when at that time we were mounting a comeback, right? And then he comes in and brick those shots. And the game was totally over. So, but that just speaks of how great a player he is. If he's struggling, you know, the team struggles. He's the machine of the team. But that game really against the Bucks really made me decide that it was booked for
it's a Star Wars thing, isn't it?
For this week,
you're meant to be the chosen one.
Yeah. but I'll still give him a pass, you know, because for everything that he's done for the Suns, staying with the Suns all these years, through the hard times, but yeah, I'd still give him that pass. It's just that I couldn't find any other Sun who had, I think, one of the worst stretches.
No.
Ever since
he
coming back
down as the greatest Sun of all time, he will.
He will. I probably say that too. He will. But it's just that ever since he came back from injury, he's averaged like 23% from three. So that's a big, big.
There seems to be like disillusion regarding his role on this roster. Like we know who he is. He knows who he is. But there just seems to be a little bit of disillusion play to play on who's going to be that guy. You know what I mean? So, God damn, it's frustrating.
Well, you know it's not frustrating.
What's the name of that nightclub of yours again?
Are you talking about the Boom Boom Room?
Yeah, the Boom Boom Room. That's it. Funky. Yeah. Funky. Yeah.
Yeah, just say, look.
And welcome back into the Suns Boom Boom Room, ladies and gentlemen, with Patty Burke hanging out with Guy Fieri, you know, and talking a little diners, drives, and dives, whatever it is. Triple D. Let's just call it Triple D. Hopefully talking about some good places to eat while over in Ireland. but, guys, we kind of touched on it before on the show, and I know Kevin put some work in here before we got started. And the talk of Suns Twitter has been the always exciting topic of turnovers. So, Kevin, can you enlighten the fans? We talked a little bit about this, the turnovers that you've been seeing, and kind of what is expected from championship teams.
Light on us, Kev.
So, interestingly, given that all the injuries that the Suns had at the start of the season, for the first 15 games of the season, they averaged like 14.9, or let's just say 15 turnovers per game for the first 15 games. Now, I looked at the last 15 games post All-Star, and their average is 14.5 turnovers per game. So that tells me that, you know, over the course of the season, you should know that your teammates' tendencies, the place, the familiarity of the place. But still, it looks like we're still turning the ball over at a high rate. They didn't improve from the first 15 games, and they didn't get worse, basically. And Jake asked me to look at the last five champions or NBA champions, what their turnovers are, or their average. The Raptors had 12.2 per turnovers per game. LA 13.7. Bucks 10.8. Warriors at 13.2, and for the Nuggets last year, 11.2. So if we're talking about the what it takes, you know, to win a championship, or one of the factors to win a championship is not turning the ball over, and it looks like we're not doing a very good job. So that really speaks volume of where we're at right now, or the Suns at right now. So I think it's that's death penalty in the playoffs. Ooh. If they continue to turn the ball over like that at that rate, we can't have that. For comparison, what I did earlier is I looked at Boston's numbers, because they had pretty much the identical number of games played. They only played 14 games post All-Star, but they're just averaging 9.8 turnovers per game, and they're the best team in the league. So we're not there yet. So we got to take care of the ball much better.
Well, but, you know,
that's really just some research there, Kev. Well done, brother.
Try not to scare our boy JC, and we don't want him crashing off the road in Santiago.
Please, JC, drive safely.
Exactly.
Drive safely. We love you, bro. Don't do that.
Yeah. Just honk your horn loud if we do something, or if the Suns do something that upsets you guys. The turnovers are a problem, have been a problem, are continuing to still be a problem. And I think from the eye test, you know, I was able to watch the games this week, and just the attempt to pass it around, you know, on the outside of the perimeter, you know, it's not like we're trying to force it into the post and people are knocking it back, because then at least at that point you can get some guys back on defense. These tend to be cross-court passes right around mid-court that are behind guys that are just, uh-oh, here comes a double, here it goes, and then somebody's camping, and they come up and they swiped away. DeJounte Murray got one, and we don't have the speed on this team to get back if that happens. So it's not just that we're turning it over. We're turning it over in a place where we can't get back, and we don't have the athleticism to get back. So it's almost an instant score every time. And I think that's why it's frustrating when we play teams like the Hawks and the 76ers without some of their top players. Both were missing, I'd say, two of their top three or four players, both teams. and they go on these double digit leads. And so it gets frustrating to watch, because then you start to see frustration. Oh, I thought he was open. And it's just like, wow. This is some of the things that I think that when some of the Suns fans were talking about, hey, we need a point guard, I think it was more like this. Can you beat a double team that tries to trap you at half court and dribble out of it without having to pull up, stop, pick up your dribble, and then try and force it to another perimeter player? Because that's where a lot of these painful turnovers, because again, we're going to have turnovers every now and then. You drive to the basket, somebody's going to try and strip you. But this is frustrating that it's taking place when we're not even in a scoring position. We're just trying to get the ball across half court, or just trying to get into the flow of the offense.
Fundamentals 101, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Bringing the ball up and court.
And that's why I think it's a little bit, you know, Ben Simmons brought that up on the PHNX podcast. He dropped down there to talk with EJ.
Sorry, Bill Simmons. You said Ben, and I immediately got angry.
Oh, did I say Ben? Bill. Okay.
I think you said Ben. Sorry, man.
Okay. Or you just really hate Ben. You smelled it. B. Simmons. You knew I was hoping.
I just found my way into.
Exactly. He probably met Ben, and I hate Ben. But Bill Simmons. No, he talked a little bit about that, and his analysis was interesting. He kind of just described it as a point guard to bring it up, you know, 25 or 30 feet, so that Booker, Durant, and Beal don't have to, because they're already playing all three of our big three close to 36 minutes a game. So does somebody have to get the wear and tear on their feet, their legs, and just dribble up past these guys and you know, try and get swiped at? Because I think it's pretty obvious now that the opposing teams, as we saw with the 76ers and Hawks, if I was on that type of a team, you know exactly what they're probably hearing is, hey, guys, it's fourth quarter. They give up in the fourth quarter. Let's go bloody their nose. Let's go swipe at them. Let's go foul them. And they'll get frustrated. And that's a problem because we've let that become a trend. And that's a problem moving into the playoffs.
Because
remember when Chris Paul and you know, and our team, we were going up against the New Orleans Pelicans. Shout out to Justin from Fanning the Flames. I was able to join him at that playoff game. And Jose Alvarado, Avocado, the man himself, the pest of Chris Paul. Oh my gosh, watching Chris Paul try and bring it up. I think he got the time violation once or twice in that playoff series of our inability to cross half court, because Alvarado was just grinding Chris Paul down. And you know what's going to happen in the playoffs is they're going to say, hey, you know what, we don't need you guys to score, so you guys go and make it extremely difficult for these guys that are not your top ball handlers in the league. Try and prevent them from getting into the flow of their offense. And I think
that's let us fall apart. They don't have to do anything. They just let us do what we do in the fourth quarter.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's
well, and I think for me, it's not just the turnovers that Kevin talked about and the where those are taking place. But for me, it's also the defense goes for three quarters of fairly effective to fourth quarter, let's let them dunk it. And it seems like, hey, we're up 10, you know, we're up 15 points. And then, you know, everyone just like, oh, he got past me. Not going to chase him down. Oh, Nurkic can't get back to it. So he's not going to be able to stop it. And all of a sudden we get a 16-point lead down to 9 points or down to 8 points, because they're just getting clear lanes to the basket. And I don't know why it always seems to happen in the fourth quarter. You would think at that point you kind of know more of the tendencies of the players you're matching up with, but that's what we've been seeing is that the defense gets more porous as the fourth quarter goes on. Somebody showed the stats off, and I forget who, so I apologize for not crediting them appropriately, but our fourth quarter defense and fourth quarter offense are among the worst in the league. So if we don't win these games in the first three quarters, it's basically a hang on type fourth quarter right now. And I mean, what do we always hear from these players? Oh, you got to play all 48 minutes. Got to play all 48 minutes. Right now, the Suns are playing about 36, and on good nights, they put in a few more minutes. And so that's what's very frustrating with this team. So I'll ask you guys this as we before we go into kind of previewing next week's games. Now that we've seen more of this team, and we've got about 14% of our schedule left, help us out in the chat. What is your current prediction for this team? Are we title bound? Are we third round exit, second round exit, first round exit? I think it's safe to say we'll be in the play-in playoff scenario. I don't think the Rockets or Jazz are going to be able to come up and clip us. So I think it's fair to say we're in. So don't need to see anyone saying we should just tank and get a pick. But you know, we've heard a lot of people say the anecdotal, this team's built for the playoffs. I still don't quite know what that means, how that means there a switch gets flipped and we perform better. So I'm going to ask you guys, what is the prediction right now? Now, not for what you hope for, but what you think currently on this current schedule that you've seen. You know, next 14 games, we could blow out everybody, and that can certainly change. But what do you think? Let's start with Hamo. If you were a betting man and you got $1,000 up on the table, how far are the Suns getting this year?
Taking hopes, emotions, dreams, first round exit. If we continue to play the way that we're playing, it's a first round exit. And I'm sorry, and you can call me not a Suns fan, you can call me whatever you want. I probably can call worse. Just today alone.
This is a group therapy session.
It's only 3 a.m. But
think of it as a group therapy session, Hamo. If somebody disagrees with you, their job is to cheer you up and tell you why.
It's annoying. We are meant to be better. I've said this so many times. We are meant to be better. And it is so frustrating watching two of the best basketballers in the league right now, as in Devin Booker and Kevin Durant, go out there and look like a monkey trying to fuck a football.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Excuse my language.
Was that bad language, or was that like an Australian thing?
No, they're looking like a monkey trying to fuck a football.
Oh, okay.
It's very frustrating. And you can tell how frustrating I am, because when we started Suns Planet, it's like, we're not going to sweat. And you know what? Fuck that. It's out the window now. It's getting really, really frustrating with...
You're supposed to do spoiler warning so that, you know, the parents, JC's probably got his kids in the car and he's driving through the streets of Santiago.
I'm sorry, but he's going
to have to pull over and have some carbonara and just calm down.
You knew the risk when you started listening to an Aussie at 3 a.m. on a Sunday. yeah, that's right, Chuck. This is therapy right now, man.
Sir Charles gets us, yeah.
But no,
another wrong little therapy to get us all ready for these,
hell yeah,
clutch games.
These upcoming. Disappointing games. Prove me wrong, Suns. Prove me wrong. But right now, you're getting bumped.
You're looking at a first round exit. And do you think that's regardless of Hamo? Do you think that's regardless of matchup right now?
It doesn't matter with the games we've seen lately. Whether it be the Hawks, the Hornets, the Bucks today with the Spurs, we'll wait and see. But it doesn't matter. Good team, bad team. We'll find a way to stuff it up ourselves. You don't need to beat us. We will beat ourselves by falling apart in the fourth with turnovers, with, you know, the whole referee calls this season is a whole nother episode. That's an episode by itself. But just everything going on right now, man, I don't have a lot of faith in our team. I'm sorry.
Okay. And to provide a little bit more perspective, right now we are currently in the seventh spot. It's certainly extremely volatile. We are in essentially a tie with Dallas, who has the sixth spot. We're a couple games back from New Orleans, who are in the fifth. Sacramento is in the eighth spot, one game back behind us. Half a game, I believe. Back behind us. So right now we would be in the play-in. We'd take on Sacramento first, and then if we would lose, we'd take on another team. But let's just say that we advance through the play-in and stay in the seventh seed. That would mean Denver Nuggets, the reigning champions, are up first. Kevin, how far is this team going?
To me, I agree with Hamo. At best, probably, I think they're a first-round exit. Over the past few weeks, we've, faced playoff teams, most especially really good playoff teams that has potentials to become the champions. And I see I think we saw a blueprint when we played the Boston Celtics. And I don't think that we've got that type of, you know, system that could take us over the finish line. Mm-hmm. Not yet, at least. That Boston team is really complete from top to bottom. And they have so many guys who can, you know, hit that three-point shot on a consistent basis. And they have Jrue Holiday. So, for me, it's...
could you imagine Jrue Holiday just pestering the Suns as they're trying to bring the ball up past half court each time?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that's what he's saving his legs for right now, is just to grind people in the dust in the playoffs.
Right. So, I don't think we have that type of that system, that the personnel as well that we have, as good as, you know, Grayson Allen had been for us, Eric Gordon, and the other guys too. But our structure is not, or our blueprint is not that good. I think at best would be a first round exit this playoffs. But hey, there's always next year.
Gee, our hopes and dreams died so quick over the last month, haven't they? And not just ours. You see it all over the internet. You see it all over Twitter. You see it all over the other brilliant social media content out there from guys like, you know, Suns Jam and PHNX and so forth. Suns fans, we have just completely, like, really, we're close to giving up. Suns fans worldwide, the Suns planet is just all feeling the same way. And it's sad.
You know what? Not going to allow for this, guys. You know why?
Based on a book by J.R.R. Tolkien, a new movie from Peter Jackson. Eric Gordon starring as Samwise Gamgee and Frank Vogel starring as Frodo Baggins, the Lord of the Rings.
I can't carry it for you, but I can carry you. Come on!
This team, no, I don't think Eric Gordon's going to carry us, but I do think that Eric Gordon, you know, that mentality is that this team can survive. This team can survive. Right now, I would put us at a prediction of second or third round. And here's why. Although currently we'd be lined up against the Nuggets, I very much think that'll shift. And what we're looking at right now, and let me go through quickly the playoff standings. Oklahoma City Thunder are at the top, you know, an unproven young team, but, you know, very talented, of course. I think that would be extremely difficult. Exactly. Denver Nuggets, again, a tough one. Minnesota Timberwolves without Karl Anthony Towns is a different team, and they have started to slide a bit. The LA Clippers are starting to slide. Russell Westbrook's had some problems. Kawhi Leonard's had some problems. Of course, staying healthy changed the record on that one.
Really?
But the Clippers seem beatable. The New Orleans Pelicans, we know about the health challenges that they have and the inconsistencies they can have. Certainly, they've been improving since the start of this calendar year, but I do think that team's beatable. I am not buying into the Luka Doncic, Kyrie Irving experiment still. I know that they have shown some degree of improvement as well, but they're just ahead of
we're
tied with them. I think Sacramento has been a disappointment this year compared to what they were hoping to try and build on. I don't fear the Lakers. I don't fear Golden State right now. So you know, if we're in one of those top two, if we're the seventh or eighth seed, it could very well be a first round exit. But I do think that this team, in a slog of a 7-game series, might be able to beat a lot of these other teams. And that's why, you know, you hear a lot of these, I think, media talking heads type stuff say, well, Suns just got to make the playoffs. We're built for the playoffs. No. We need a good seed in the playoffs. And maybe not something like third. I mean, that'd be phenomenal, you know, if something like that happened. But we've already seen teams like the Pelicans drop super winnable games. Like the Charlotte Hornets won last night against a playoff team. I forget who it was that they ended up beating, but let me take a quick look, because I remember I was shocked to see who they ended up beating. Was it the Cavs? No. This is going to be great. Great tuning in.
Well, while you look that up, I just want to apologize to our man JC. Yes, he does have the children in the car. And no, not all Australians talk like that. Yes, they do. I'm sorry. That's a lie. But I'm sorry, kids. Uncle Hammo didn't mean it. He's not angry. It's okay. I love you. I love you, Dad. So please don't get angry. And also, Charles, can you send me a DM on Twitter, dude? Because I need you to be like my life coach and just feed me positive. Because your positivity is through the roof, bro. No, please hit me up on Twitter, man. I really, really need to talk to you about this. This is awesome. I love it.
Well, so just to clarify, so I was wrong. It wasn't the Hornets, but it was the Washington Wizards beat the Sacramento Kings. So, you know, there's it's always good to come up out of the hidey hole and look at the other fan bases and go, oh, they're as pissed off as we are about our own team's inconsistencies. So I do think I agree with a lot of what you guys said. I don't like this system right now. I don't like the lazy turnovers. That's really what they are at that mid-court level. I mean, that's like junior high level of basketball where you just keep trying to force it to somebody else and then it gets the ball picked off. But this team, you know, I don't buy into the Mavericks or the Kings or the Pelicans right now. So I think we would have trouble winning at all.
Real threat.
But what's going to be interesting, of course, is the next round of games, which let's get into real quick and try and end reasonably on time. But as I mentioned, we have a couple games, including one coming up in 7 hours, if it's on my time zone, against the San Antonio Spurs, followed by a game at San Antonio, which I actually like this, a back-to-back where you don't have to travel back and forth. I feel like the NBA always messes this up. They'll be like, all right, Suns at L.A., and then the next game is Suns against L.A. in Phoenix. It's like, why are you guys making them just have the back-to-back in that same place and come back later for the other one? But so we have both San Antonio games. Remember, Spurs beat us twice in Phoenix earlier in this year. But we have the Spurs both times in San Antonio. That is two of our next 12 games. Then the gauntlet begins. Denver Nuggets at Denver, at the Oklahoma City Thunder. We move into April to go at New Orleans. Cleveland Cavaliers come to visit. Minnesota Timberwolves come to visit. Pelicans come to visit. Clippers. Then we go at the Clippers. See, there's one that we have to travel right after we beat them. And then we have the Kings and the Timberwolves. So as I mentioned, it's the easy part of the schedule are these next two games, which we've already dropped to the Spurs. So, but look, breaking it down just for the week ahead before the next show, Spurs, Denver, Oklahoma City Thunder, Hammo, predictions on the next week. And yes, that is.
I'm going to do it twice in an episode. Fuck.
It's a five-game road trip, but four for the before we pod again. So,
look, we all know the juggernaut that Denver can be. It's not only that; every sports fan knows. You know, Mile High City, altitude, all that. It is harder to play in. OKC, their home court is one of the loudest fan bases in the league. Mm-hmm. Which is always tough, and they are putting together some amazing stuff. Chet Holmgren is really starting to dominate, starting to feel what he can do. Like he's starting to feel himself, but not in that kind of way. He's really starting to come into his what he can do with his body, and it's going to be so frustrating, man. It's going to be so tough. I'm getting positive vibes coming from everyone else, and I'm trying to emulate that. But this is going to be tough, and this is going to test the resolve of Suns fans around the planet. It's going to test us all, Planeteers. It really will. So I'm going in with high hopes, but a lot of hesitation as well. It's going to be tough, dude. It's going to be very tough. Prediction wise for this week, I want to say 50-50, but I think that might be a stretch. But okay. I'm going to say two and two.
And you think what, the two wins over Spurs, or do you think we split it?
We split the Spurs.
Oof.
And we'll win against OKC.
Ooh. Well, hey, beating the best team in the West right now would not be the worst way to end that week. But
it's just what I feel. Just what I feel.
I want to point out that what's extremely sad about the San Antonio team is they are 15th in the West right now. They are the worst team. Let's try and handle them this time. Kevin, predictions for the week.
Come on, Kev.
Yes, yeah. Four games this week, right?
That's right.
Including tonight. So I want to be as positive as Charles, and I agree with what
he's making
said.
It very hard to not be positive, right?
Yeah, I'd hate to be the pessimist out of the group, but I'd go 3-1. I'd say we sweep the Spurs, and then we lose to the Nuggets and win Thunder.
Oh, sorry, you cut off a little bit there. What was the last bit?
We sweep the Spurs.
Okay.
We lose to the Nuggets, and we win against the Thunder.
Ooh, so 3-1?
3-1, yes.
Ooh.
Now you're the theme to the People's Court.
Sorry, I just thought that'd lift your spirits a little bit, Hamo. We'll take you to the People's Court again on another date.
I was just about to go see if I could find him, that
was all. Looking for Judge Hammer. No, I love it. I'm going to say 2-2. I'm going to say 2-2 until I see a little bit more. But I tell you what, picking up a couple wins against the Spurs would be certainly handling the business. Those, I think, to me, are very much must wins. Perhaps even more so than trying to knock off the two top teams. Although, you know, what might end up helping this Suns team is that as it sounds weird to say, as the top teams prepare for the playoffs, they might start resting guys. Now, I think it's a little too early for them to do that. They'll probably look at that a little bit more in April. So that might be in future weeks. But, you know, there's not as much reason to play SGA or a Joker, you know, 40 minutes a game to try and make sure that you're going to have a top spot when it clearly looks like you'll have a top spot. So
that's a good call.
Yeah, there is that chance. But right now I'm going to say 2-2. It's a little frustrating, but we're here for the ride and watch. If we go 3-1.
We're Suns fans. We're used to being frustrated.
We'll feel like, hey, guys, look out. Didn't I say we were going to win the title? So absolutely. So as we close out the show, Kevin, where can Suns Planeteers find you on the internet?
Hey, you can find me at I'm Kevin Salute in X or Twitter, and that's that. I don't tweet much, but sometimes I do every Suns game. But definitely, you can find me there.
Okay. Oh, and real quick, Kevin. Is there an alcohol that I should be drinking that comes from the Philippines? I know we didn't really do a on destination episode, but we do have a pretty wide variety liquor store, alcohol store in my neck of the woods, and
we like to drink.
You know, if I can't make blood soup or black soup, or some of that other good stuff you talked about on the previous episode, what should I get that I can be like, oh, I feel like I'm an actual Filipino right now, you know, maybe minus the karaoke.
Like it's some sort of rum.
Yeah, Tanduay is always good.
What is it?
Tanduay. Uh-huh. I can. Yeah, I'll give you that link later. And then
he'll hook you up. You know it's a guy.
That sounds mildly inappropriate. Like, don't worry, I'll send you the link later.
Sorry about that, but it's not what
Kevin's only thing. Fans. No,
me too.
I don't have that either. So, Tanduay, and we talked about Red Horse, right? The last time I was here.
Yeah.
So you can try that, and as well as.
What's the best beer over there? What's the most popular beer?
I think the best beer over here is for me, it's the Pale Pilsen, San Miguel Pale Pilsen. So it's less calories, but the beer tastes.
I was not expecting great. That.
Yeah. So
sounds like Kevin was writing the ads for that company. Less calories, same taste.
Well, just a disclaimer, I don't run any promotions
for these guys. We are currently unsponsored. At the moment, so just Bilsons, if you're listening,
Yeah, that's right.
I'll send them the video later. But right. Yeah, those are the must haves in terms of, you know, alcohol beverages. So
nice.
Try that. Jake, I'll send you that link later. Again, it's not inappropriate. It's just those things.
I'll send you and Kev a link later. And yes, it is inappropriate.
Well, I've got some good news, too. I know we'll be going to Paraguay soon. I've been hyping that up for a little while. But our man, Ariel, is ready to go down there and talk to us a little bit about the Suns fandom of Paraguay. And we've got a lead potentially going to Canada soon. So you'd think, gosh, what's the deal? Why haven't you guys gotten up to Canada yet? We are trying. Got to identify the Suns fans willing to come on from these places and get them ready to go. But Hamo, where can people find you? And why don't you drink Australian wine? What is your problem? It's fantastic.
It keeps coming back to me not drinking wine. look, you it's can find me at you. Sir Hamo on grapes. Twitter. Yes. Yeah, I do love grapes. Actually, you know what? I'm not against wine. I'm really not. It's just it's not something that someone my age, my lifestyle goes out and orders. If I'm out for dinner or something like that with my partner Jayana, I'll get a cocktail before I get a glass of wine, just the way it is. But yeah, you can find me at Sir Hamo on Twitter. You can find me here every week, trying not to sweat. You can also follow us on what are we on nowadays, Jake? I can't even remember. We're on every platform. You can find us everywhere.
YouTube, find us everywhere. Spotify.
Look out the window right now. Jake's standing out in your backyard. Okay?
That's probably true.
You think he's here live? Nope.
I'm drinking a Red Horse because Kevin sent me the link.
Yeah, he's already in Paraguay. Oh my goodness. I'm already in Paraguay. No, look, this is you know, we mentioned therapy before, but this is an absolutely beautiful thing. Couldn't go one week without saying it. I love hanging out with you guys. I love talking Suns. We've got a really rough road ahead. But just keep tuning in, guys. We'll give you as much information and as many hot takes as we can. And the future of the Sun is bright, and that is the only way it is.
I'm not going to read that one, but I'll let everyone else read it. Huntstar is right, though. That's even where else we can be found. But you know, one person we didn't mention real quick, but I did want to say I did see his one amazing block this week, and so it was good to see he actually had a decent little game. So quick drop for the man, Mr. Drew Eubanks.
Steward, you son of a bitch.
Drew Eubanks makes the Isaiah Stewart punch like a champ, and of course, getting those blocks that you thought were just for sure going in against us. No, Drew Eubanks came and timed it perfectly. You can find
that one yesterday, man. He sent that back to the dinosaur.
Yeah,
that's right. You can find me at Fallen Founder, and thanks for tuning in, everybody, and thanks Kevin for stopping by. And we'll see you guys again soon. And I'll just say good morning, Al McCoy, and good night to the rest of these guys on this pod. Time for them to go back to sleep. All right. And take it away, Al.
Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, stay with us as the Suns get set to shine here on their home court.
Here's Perry, the guard heard. Here's the jump shot. Good! It's good!
Al McCoy with you courtside. Pumped up a three.
Shoots in! He ties it!
Here's Cameron Payne out on top. Durant, three-pointer straight away.
I just want to take this opportunity to thank everyone in this arena this afternoon, to all of those that are watching and listening on radio and TV. A thank you for allowing me to tell the story of the Suns for 51 great years.
That pretty much wraps things up here. And for one last time, this is Al McCoy saying thanks for being there. Thanks for being with us tonight. And from the Footprint Center here in downtown Phoenix, we'll just say so long for now.